What the pandemic has shown us is that we've compressed time. What I mean by that is that we've seen 5 or 6 years innovation compressed into 8 to 9 months. We've now got open door of innovation. We've got less rules and regulations. People are now working with industrial partners, and also healthcare workers become more innovative in their approach and to adopt new ideas and new ways of thinking. And that's great, not just for now, the future of healthcare as we see it. But of course, go back only 18 months ago, you've seen the WHO issue its own recommendations on digital interventions for health to strengthen healthcare systems around the world. As part of the SDGs, they showed 10 areas that could be globally by the digital thinking. And as they revisit this, there'll be many, many more opportunities for digital interventions for global health impact. If we see where we are now and what could be driven in the future, a look at the health and care system of this new brave world, we know that digital is going to be the fundamental component of that system. We are, of course, going to be more connected, as we've seen over the pandemic. Most important thing, of course, is about being precise and personalized, and that means having good data to drive the healthcare system. And that makes the healthcare more efficient, of course, going forward. There's no question we've seen more integration, and as we've seen that, that will develop further with issues around interoperability and connected health and all the records being available to the patient. And so it's patient empowerment is going to be the key in the future. We've seen a change from this hierarchical method of healthcare to a more balanced healthcare system. And now we're seeing a multidisciplinary approach and a different way of working. People working flexible hours at home, for example, different ways, and patients also look at different ways of working in the future. The first thing to think about is that connected health. And that's really important because we've seen the pandemic affect people in lower socioeconomic groups, such as BAME people. And these are the key workers in health services around the world and also society. So we need to improve social care, there's no question. Huge amount of income and money is put into social care to improve the outcome and the services. And now, of course, it's more connected. People have telemedicine at home, they have remote sensors and monitors. So actually, a lot of the work we did before could be done remotely. There has to be a seamless approach from social to primary and secondary care. Of course, there'll be new ideas, new ways of working, but also new concepts and technology and innovation within those sectors. Sharing records, sharing information, seamless, avoiding unnecessary outpatient appointments, unnecessary admissions. It's about making the healthcare system work much better efficiently with the same resource. And we're learning that from the global pandemic. Also, we've seen the change the way we consult with our patients. Telemedicine's taken off. And this is a picture from 1924. The futurists were talking about the way that we could consult with our doctors, and they talk about radio waves. What they're describing, of course, 100 years ago is the advent of telemedicine. And we've been in the right place. We've seen what's called total triage. Patients coming in to a healthcare system, but being triaged using technology. So most patients don't need to be seen face to face. And we've seen in major centers around the world that telemedicine is up by up to 8,000% utilization compared to only 9 or 10 months ago. Huge explosion of companies offering 24-hour service. That's great. It's immediate, it's convenient, and patients demanding this kind of healthcare system. And I think that's what we should deliver. We live in a one-click world due to Amazon, and this is now a one-click healthcare system, allowing health to be accessed immediately, and it's becoming more affordable, of course, less expensive. If we scale up that whole idea of telemedicine, this is Ping An from China, an insurance company. A year ago, they had on their books 300 million active users of their telemedicine platform. Can you imagine? That's almost the entire population of the US. Also, they had 160,000 consultations per day. That was a year ago. I don't know what the numbers are now, but they're going to be much greater than that, of course. We're seeing this great scaling of the technologies globally, learning from different disciplines, different countries, etc. And that's really important as we go on. We may move, of course, primary care into booths. This is, again, in China, where they're now producing small booths. We can actually see a doctor or a healthcare professional in a booth, have your blood pressure and your vitals taken, for example. If you need medication, you can go next door, pick up with a smart card, and pick up medicines. Immediate access at home, remotely, taking away the cost involved of having a traditional method of a healthcare hospitals and secondary care, for example. It's going to change the framework, and this will, I'm sure, be more common as we go forward. We've also challenged the way we think about healthcare. A year ago, this doctor in California appeared via video link and broke bad news of a patient. He died. This created a lot of controversy at the time, and the doctor was criticized heavily. That was a year ago. A year on now, we're breaking bad news all the time in telemedicine. Who would have thought? Now we can break bad news, patient okay, with a cancer diagnosis being managed remotely. Of course, it's not perfect. There has to be a balance in the future, but we've seen that a lot of clinic appointments were unnecessary, saving billions of dollars of money across the globe, reducing the contact with doctors. Always been expensive. This is my own clinic in the hospital. This is me with my smart tablet, with the video software on my laptop, with electronic health record. I can do all from home, remotely, seeing my patients, appearing on a waiting list, etc. This is common now for most people. I can do ward rounds remotely, use my beam system, going around the wards. And patients are very happy now. You don't have to be there, being remote. When I did this 5 years ago with my beam system, there was a lot of pushback. Now, of course, it's an open door. Now we can actually manage patients remotely. Talking about remoteness, we're going to manage the chronic diseases more. We know the health costs are rising year on year. GDP is going up in every country around the world. It's becoming unaffordable. So chronic disease is a huge burden. Diabetes, COPD, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, and COPD. So these are the kind of things we've got to think differently. We were seeing patients more regularly, and we realized it was unnecessary. People can manage remotely using smart technology. We're going to see more patient empowerment. We're going to see it's more data-driven. Here we are. So smart inhalers, looking at the way you breathe, for example, in asthma, COPD, uptake of the medicines, your temperature, etc., all can be measured using smart kind of inhalers and breathing machines, if you like. Diabetics, this is the Libre system with a little device that's inserted into your skin, giving real-time 24-hour monitoring for type 1 diabetics. Much better, of course, than being using the HbA1c every 3 to 6 months. This is real-time monitoring. The data can be shared with the doctor, etc. Also, we've seen the artificial pancreas coming in. There'll be more and more data coming through across all illnesses and diseases. So we have to now be ready for this deluge of data and this remote care, and understand what it means, and understand the limitations where we need to see a patient face-to-face, and when we don't need to see a patient. So it's going to be a kind of a hybrid model in the future, and lessening the expense required to see a patient. And since it's evolving now, we're seeing more sensors on the skin, under the skin, we're seeing ingestibles, and nanobots coming in. And of course, the Apple Watch 6 has come out recently, and it's also sharing ECG data for atrial fibrillation, as well as monitoring oxygen levels. That's very useful in the COVID pandemic to measure your own O2 levels, which I have been one of them, and it's reasonably accurate. So you can see now we're going to be more mobile, more sensors, and sensors soon will be embedded into clothes. So your real clothes will have embedded sensors, and you can walk around and be measured constantly, giving lots of amount of data around your general fitness and well-being. Of course, the other thing that's come out of the pandemic that's been crucial is the improvement in the private-public partnerships. So it's been difficult to access healthcare systems for private companies. In the UK, the companies used to run away scared because of the inertia, the barriers, and the general difficulty in accessing healthcare systems. We've seen a change. We've seen now life sciences get together to sort out vaccines and clinical trials very quickly. We've seen acceleration of care because it's been necessary for certain disciplines within the pandemic. We've seen really fast research trials being carried out across the globe to look at medicines for COVID. And we've seen the ones that have been good, ones that have been bad, etc. But it's been fast paced. We've also seen innovation hubs set up by major companies to help support innovation in healthcare systems. And now we're looking at new models of reimbursement and investment within healthcare. And that's great in terms of how we manage that future partnerships going forward. A few examples. I have to be an advisor for the Abu Dhabi Government for Health. And what they've done, of course, is connected the healthcare system, all 50 institutions, with a central healthcare information exchange. What they're doing, of course, now connecting data, collecting it, having a dashboard, so in real-time monitoring of the healthcare system. They've set up a Hub 71. This is a innovation hub that's been funded by Mubadala, their state sovereign fund, to the tune of about $4 billion, bring innovation into Abu Dhabi to help support their startup system, bring new fresh ideas to improve their healthcare. So this is what nations can do and have learned during the pandemic. This, of course, more collaboration. On the top left, you see COVAX. This is WHO WHO's own kind of amalgamation of 184 countries getting together to provide vaccines, technology, disseminate it. This has been great ambition, and it's been collaboration between big companies, pharma and the WHO, and governments, of course. We've seen McLaren and UCL in London get together very quickly to derive new ventilators. New ventilators would be a problem in the beginning, and they mass produced a very simple CPAP ventilator, which is now widely available, and the blueprint is available to all to use, very cost effective. Ours happened to be one of the surgical leads at the Nightingale Hospital, a field hospital built by the military, brought in by experts, and also the NHS, military, plus other providers like Cerner, like Vodafone, Telco, all coming together to produce a hospital within 3 or 4 weeks. It shows it can be done. We've seen now major trials, people amalgamating data very quickly. The recovery trial is an important one, showing all the efficacy of drugs being used across the nation and globally. So we've seen these kind of collaborations being really pushed hard by the pandemic. If you look at surgery, my own discipline, we know there's a huge problem. Over the course of the first few months, it's estimated that in 3 months, that 28.4 million operations were cancelled within a three-month period of the pandemic. Okay. Also, over 2 million cancer operations will be cancelled. Can you imagine globally what the impact of that has? And of course, we know that we will cancel about 70% of all operations going forward. What do we do about recovery? How do we overcome this burden? What do we learn? Do we have to rechange where we work? Do we have to offer more working hours during the week and Saturdays and Sundays for elective work? Do we have to change the way the model? I think we have to be able to overcome the deficit over the next 2 or 3 years to improve the access to those patients for operations. Here's an example of what's been done. This is the Bradford Hospitals. GE Healthcare have built in their own wall of analytics. It's an AI system. We're using data across the entire hospital, showing flow across the hospital, showing real data of bed occupancy, discharges, the use of theatre allocation, where the problems are, predicting how to use the hospital more efficiently, to use that time better. So we're seeing now these command centres in hospitals being set up. Huge amounts of data to improve efficiency and flow across a hospital. And that can only be a good thing. Hopefully it will improve efficiency and costs. Then we have to go back. Obviously we're living in a digital world. So how do we train the future doctors of tomorrow? And we failed. The curriculums haven't changed in anticipation of these new findings. However, 5 years ago, I thought about this and knew that we had to do something different. So I introduced a Bart's X course into our curriculum for all medical students, all 450 in our medical school at Bart's, bringing innovation, technology, entrepreneurship into the program. Teach them about coding, businesses, developing ideas, innovation. We have venture capitalists speaking to them. We have people from industry. We have these, and they kind of think about going to groups of 4 or 5, getting an idea, pitching the idea to a dragon's den. Because we want the future leaders to understand the language of digital technologies and to be able to think new ideas of how we're going to impact healthcare and education. This is our group last year. We were face-to-face. This year, 3 days ago, we did it obviously on Microsoft Teams, which is different, but again, huge engagement of that. And then we've seen now from our medical school, the rise of medical entrepreneurs. People now thinking differently, becoming exponential in their thinking and designing new ideas for themselves and for future generations. This has got to be the way we train the new leaders of tomorrow. If we look at the other kind of technologies, we talk about extended reality, which encompasses augmented reality on one hand and virtual reality at the other. In the middle is something called mixed reality. All combined, these are called extended realities. So we know they're coming in. We've seen really amazing technologies like overlaying information, helping in navigation through an operation, planning both pre, during, and post operation. We're seeing great amounts of data being collected in that sense. So it makes us much more, I guess, able to manage a patient better and hopefully improve outcomes. So these technologies are coming in as we speak. They've also now been given FDA approval. This is not science fiction. These can be used tomorrow to monitor patients and to use them before the operation plan the surgery in orthopedics, in neurosurgery, another discipline. So we're seeing great emphasis on that. We're also seeing training come in. And this is my own company creating a virtual reality platform. We're seeing now huge interest in remote learning. We've gone to online platforms to immersive technology. And so about 3 or 4 years ago, we produced the world's first interactive platform, so you can interact in VR, learn remotely. And although 3 or 4 years ago is early in its inception and before its time, now we're seeing a huge escalation of interest in remote learning, virtual learning. We know that it's effective. We've seen some reports that there's much more engagement in VR training, better knowledge retention, and also more engagement, and people much more confident after VR learning, and simulations coming in, etc., going forward. So these are the kind of platforms we'll be seeing in the future fairly quickly at all medical schools and all healthcare institutions, replacing, augmenting conventional learning platforms. I used the Google Glass back in 2014 to live stream an operation, which you can read about on the net, and how many people reached by just doing a simple operation using smart technology. We've moved on from that. We're now using smart technologies in the ambulances, at the point of contact where a patient is in a trauma situation. And also now we're seeing these mixed reality devices being used for a smart ambulance in Milan and other places now. So we relay information quickly. The golden hour will change because that information ready for you filtered through this technology. And 5G, of course, mobile 5G is going to revolutionize the Internet of Medical Things. Enabler. It's the bit that was missing, the ingredient that we needed to connect all these things we've been describing. The Internet of Things, or Internet of Medical Things, can be powered by 5G technology because it has latency of 0.1 millisecond, which is imperceptible, and a download speed of 2 to 3 gigabytes per second. So it's going to be revolutionizing the amount of data we can use to revolutionize healthcare. I've also worked with the idea of how do we do more remote working? And I've been working with holograms, avatars for the last few years, experimenting what it could be like doing an MDT remotely, connecting with your colleagues. We've seen now Zoom and others being used for this collaboration. But a few years ago, I thought we can do better. This is me during the pandemic, connecting using a smartphone or a Magic Leap system, connecting with my colleagues in America and describing the COVID pandemic.
Hey, Ahmed, good to see you again.
Hey, Harrison, so good to see you. Where are you?
I'm in New York. How about you?
I'm in London. So good to see you. I think we've got Ian here as well, haven't we? Hi, Ian.
Hey, guys. I'm in downtown Atlanta right now. Thanks for joining me. I forgot my Magic Leap, but I've got my phone handy, so joining you through here.
Thanks for joining us.
So here we just show we can share images, we can do an MDT in different ways, etc., and be remote, but somehow replicate human behavior, which we so desire. What about if we move on to the world of digital humans, replacing us with an empathic, AI-driven digital human?
Hi, I'm Roman, a digital human brought to life by soul machines. With me, you can experience AI like never before because I learn and react emotionally like humans do.
So that's a glimpse of the future. We just mentioned AI. So AI is obviously going to be huge. It's going to power healthcare over the next 10, 20, 30 years. It's had false promise, false starts, but now we're seeing good ideas, AI and deep machine learning, so that it can improve access to healthcare, but also help us improve the efficiency of our systems. We know already, of course, from much data out there, that it's great for images in terms of pathology images, or indeed chest x-rays, CT scans, MRIs, etc., because it's very good at mimicking a doctor, and actually being better than doctors, in fact, for diagnostic purposes. And we've seen DeepMind work on early retinopathy with a team at Moorfields in London. But what about COVID? We've seen actually COVID now being used with AI in x-rays. A team from the UK called QAI have been analyzing many, many sets of COVID images, and the QAI platform can actually diagnose very quickly and predict the outcome of COVID because of early changes in chest x-rays and CT scans. So already we're seeing that dissemination very quickly. We're also seeing AI being used for the COVID in terms of development of drugs and vaccines, new molecular targets very quickly, which will take in months and years before, early detection and diagnostics for the infection, and now screening, tracking and predicting current and future patients. So we're now seeing the world of COVID be accelerated in terms of AI support. And this is my own discipline. I'm a colorectal surgeon. This AI being used in endoscopy, picking out polyps. This is the GI Genius system by Medtronic, and can find polyps that you might not see yourself, improving the outcome for those patients, because of course some of these polyps could become cancerous in the future. So predictive modeling is great, and AI has become greater images. We've seen diagnostics like ultrasound also being converged, being more mobile. Now we're seeing mobile images for Butterfly and other companies on a smartphone, etc. Soon AI will power that, and AI will then be able to diagnose things remotely, and anyone could do the ultrasound. You don't have to be trained, which makes sense, because lack of workforce we have around the globe, which will make a smarter workforce work in different ways, which is the key of providing support. During the COVID, we're seeing chatbots being used. It's a decision tree making, simple AI algorithm. Have you got COVID or not? Here's a questionnaire exercise, Q&A. And now we've got Babylon and others who are working on concept of chatbots has been the first premise. We've seen the term total triage come in. Everyone's being triaged in the beginning to work out whether they have an illness or not, in the case of COVID, where to send them. So now these decision-making trees are much more complex, allows a lot of filtering of patients that don't need to be seen unnecessarily. Only those that need to be seen can be filtered out very quickly. And that improves efficiency and cost, of course. And of course, moving on to the whole world of new way of consulting. This is the Babylon platform where using natural language processing, using real-time analytics, AI, using diagnostics, in real time as you're speaking to the patient, everything's filled in for you, and then you can actually make a diagnosis at the end of that. So this is going to be the next method, model of consulting with patients. And of course, you know, voice tech is important. Voice tech is coming in. Alexa may be your first point of contact in health in the future. It makes sense. If there's no face-to-face, much safer being at home and being treated at home. We see people predict outcomes using your voice vocal biomarkers, predicting ischemic heart disease, heart failure, and others using your breath and your voice because it's a powerful medium. Maybe we can treat people remotely for mental health disorders and other illnesses that we'd often have not be able to manage properly in the practices. Last few slides. Looked at, of course, these remote areas now. 3D printing is coming in, it's becoming cheaper. We're seeing the advent of drones. So there's no question 3D printing is becoming cheaper and more affordable. And we're seeing more of these being used globally for different accesses. My own field of surgery, we can produce instruments now. And remember the globe being remote, low income countries, new ways of thinking. And this may be a cost-effective method for some of the ideas to implant into people's bodies in terms of 3D printing. And more recently, we've seen drones come in to transport things. We've seen vaccines being potentially used by drones, medicines remotely, not just in Africa and Asia and other low middle income countries, also in the US. We've seen a drone flying a transplant from one part to the other in New York recently. And all this governed by a new way of localized navigation using three words, for example, which localize 1 meter square on anywhere in the world. So suddenly this delivery platform is much better, giving life-saving treatments, and we're learning that during the pandemic, which will be necessary when we give vaccines out over the next 12 months, how to get to people very quickly. This may be an opportunity to use some of these technologies. So this has been a kind of whistle tour of COVID pandemic and also where we are and where we're heading towards. I hope you understood my story, where I'm coming from. I'll leave you with one last statement from William Gibson, who said a while ago, the future is already here. It's just not even distributed yet. And we're seeing now the convergence of technologies and innovation, and this global pandemic is pushing us to drive global solutions. Thank you.
Hi, Shweta and everyone. Thank you for the opportunity and having me here today. It's exciting to speak to Indo-US Business Forum. I am an Indian-American for the last 20 years, been here in the Northern Virginia, D.C. area, which is where I'm joining you from. I am a genomics data scientist by training and have been in the precision medicine revolution that's unfolded for since the Human Genome Project that was completed in around 2000. And that's when I moved from being a core computational scientist into a genomics data scientist. And over the years, I've spent a number of years at National Institutes of Health and FDA analyzing next generation DNA sequencing data for a variety of diseases and how it has an impact on various aspects, including in agriculture and other areas. So it's really special for me to be here as I have been working at the intersection of US and India and where the opportunities lie for the two countries to collaborate, particularly focused on rare diseases. As I have been a social entrepreneur last 8 years now, primarily driven by my own personal experience of having a child in with rare disease, and so I have dedicated to accelerating the development of new therapies to treat rare diseases, and I see that this is a global issue and requires collaboration both on the advocacy and policy changes as well as technology. So I'll be walking you through some of my learnings and my efforts. So just to distinguish social entrepreneurship from serial entrepreneurship, a social entrepreneur may found more than one for-profit or non-profit organizations, but they all are looking to address a social problem. In my case, it is the rare disease and the process of developing treatments. So I'm mainly purpose-driven, as I had to undergo a life-changing event, and that set me on a mission to accelerate the development of diagnostics and therapies, primarily the speed of developing these treatments, as it has become unsustainable over the last few decades. Although clinical trials are amazing in terms of being the most complex endeavor undertaken by humankind, and the thousands of drugs that we do access on a daily basis that we take for granted have gone through a very complex process and rigorous process to ensure safety and efficacy. It is a significant endeavor undertaken by biopharmaceutical companies and medical device companies. So, but it can get better. The industry has been resistant to change and adopt, make any changes to this highly complex, highly risky endeavor for various good reasons, but also it's time with the COVID pandemic to adopt change as it has become a necessity now and not an option. So let me quickly walk you through the patient perspective and the patient journey in a with a rare disease in particular, how that might be different compared to a common disease. You know, majority of patients with rare disease remain undiagnosed on an average for 5 to 7 years. And once they eventually get diagnosed with the right disease, only about 5% of them will likely find an FDA-approved treatment available. Majority of them remain without a FDA-approved treatment. And so what they end up having to do is probably enroll in a clinical trial, which there are about close to 2,000 clinical trials that are currently underway. And that means diagnosed with a rare disease, that's probably where a bulk of the patients want to be. But many of them find themselves where they are diagnosed with a rare disease without any ongoing trial or without any FDA approved treatments. And so what they need, they can also do a certain, channel their anger, frustration, and their need for treatment in the right direction of building patient registries, natural history studies, and working towards getting that therapy for their rare condition. And so what this necessitates is clinical trial as a care option, which is currently not the standard of care, as only about 1.2% of all cancer patients in the United States are enrolling in clinical trials. A vast majority are left with the standard of care, which is lacking in many of these rare disease cases for sure. And so there is a number of global initiatives such as the Undiagnosed Diseases Network International, the Global Commission to End Diagnostic Odyssey for Children with a Rare Disease, which is a collaborative between Microsoft, Takeda Pharmaceuticals, and the European Rare Disease Society. Newborn screening initiatives on a country-by-country basis and even state level, where they have their own newborn screening, because getting early diagnosis is so critical. And so there is a number of concerted effort at the global scale. So diagnosis, patient registry or natural history studies to understand the disease itself, and clinical trials, and once there's therapy, monitoring the patients long-term on how they are responding to treatments and their safety and efficacy. So within the my own journey in rare disease as a social entrepreneur began around 2012. And since then, I have founded the Organization for Rare Diseases in India, as we had the National Organization for Rare Disorders in the US and Global Genes and a number of Every Life Foundation that was getting formed around that time. All doing yeoman service and over 30 years already. Whereas in India, did not have a definition for a rare disease, nor a policy. But today we do have a definition. And in the US, a disease is rare if it affects fewer than 200,000 Americans. And in India, they adopted a definition that's any disease that affects fewer than 500,000 Indians. So we summarized the findings of the initial discovery of interviewing various key opinion leaders, medical geneticists, patients, and patient advocates, and published the results in the Genetics Research Journal in 2014. And since then, have been looking at awareness education as a primary unmet need. Also, government policy at the national and state level in a given country is so critical. And in the US, we have the Orphan Drug Act, which provides various incentives for pharmaceutical and biotech companies developing drugs for rare indications, which do not exist in most other countries yet, except for the EU as an exception, and Japan. And so we set out the Organization for Rare Diseases India on that mission to advocate and raise awareness and work towards policy, where I founded this next nonprofit organization, Indo-US Organization for Rare Diseases, which is based here in the US, which advocates with the FDA, with the biotech sponsors to go global, think global, and particularly engage the Indian subcontinent, which has over, close to a quarter of the world's population is just in that Indian subcontinent. And so that's so important to engage as we have come as far as we can in the US and EU with the rare disease, moving forward to accelerate and speed up patient enrollment in clinical research and understand the disease better. We need more diversity and global engagement. It's a global issue. And, as we move along the continuum, you'll see that there's need for translational research, understanding of genetics, but also the phenotypic heterogeneity that exists in these rare diseases. They may have a single gene mutation that causes the rare disease, 80% of them, roughly. But a single gene mutation can cause a complex set of phenotypes that affect the patient. And so there is equal importance that has to be given to both the genetics aspect as well as the symptoms and phenotypes. And that's where the molecular diagnostics to do comprehensive molecular profiling, particularly in cancer, that has shown a significant improvement in outcomes, but also for a variety of other rare and ultra rare diseases. And finally, ultimately affecting the drug development timelines. So if you look at the process of bringing a new therapy to market, there's roughly about 320,000 clinical trials registered in the clinical trials database in the US, which covers probably about 80% of all the global clinical trials. The therapy has to go through phase one, where safety is tested on healthy volunteers, and then phase two, And then phase three, where safety and efficacy is studied on a variety of doses on different types of patients and so forth. So determining the safety and efficacy of that is where it is very critical. And that's part of the FDA's mission, is to ensure safety of all participants during the clinical trial, and that the risk they take is worth the benefit that the potential therapy offers. And so, but that process is very inefficient and takes quite a bit of time to get the study started with the right set of investigators who are qualified to run the study and who have access to patient populations that could be enrolled into the study itself. So to address some of these inefficiencies in this process, can we do this instead of 7 years from when the first phase clinical trial begins? Can we squeeze, what is the opportunity to squeeze this up? that's the grand challenge that I went after. And we received a grant from the National Science Foundation last year to study this and understand by listening and interviewing customer stakeholders, particularly in rare disease, as to why it takes so long. What are the inefficiencies? What are the causes of inefficiency? And so the orphan drugs, which are drugs meant to treat rare diseases, they take twice longer compared to non-orphan drugs for the development process. And the FDA did a phenomenal job of speeding up the review process for particularly for orphan drugs. But the review is the last 1 year, you know, which FDA reduced to 6 months or less. But that's still leaves us with 6 years of the clinical development process itself. And that too in a small population that affects the rare, that's affected by the rare disease, you know, there is significant inefficiency and the return on investment has to be done on from a smaller population compared to common disease. And so what we heard from the biotech sponsors, CROs, research investigators is that there is a number of different a la carte tools available for, you know, for patient recruitment, for collecting patient outcomes data, making clinical assessments remotely, and so forth. But and now video conferencing for telehealth visits, they have to be put together, you know, in a single solution and has to be validated by the sponsor, and training has to be provided to the study team conducting the clinical trial as well as the patients using these studies to participate. So there is a number, it's a huge upfront burden of vendor selection and training and validation, which also results in poor user experience. And, you know, stakeholders told us every clinical trial feels like the first ever trial undertaken by mankind. Even though we have been doing this for about 100 years now, it feels that way. And so how do we overcome some of these burden? Second, you know, average clinical trial has about 3 protocol amendments during a 18-month period on an average. And what that means is every time the protocol changes as to what samples are collected, what data is collected, and how it is done, they have to reconsent the patients. And so they have to bring the patient back into the clinic to make sure they understand and provide a informed consent again. And so that's very inefficient. And in the COVID era, getting patients back into the clinic, unless it's a critical thing, is not preferred. And so we need the remote, touchless, informed consenting type approach, as well as ensuring that the study can continue and retain its integrity over a period of time. So I won't have time to go into great detail about each of these things, but you see that there is a number of aspects of the clinical study end to end. And the bottom line is, we need to save time, cost, and provide better user experience. That's the key. Nobody said they had a good experience of participating in a clinical study or conducting a clinical study, irrespective of who we spoke with. Nobody had a good experience. So that tells us that there is a huge need to streamline this process, make the process you know, worth going through. So the one big challenge, like I pointed out, is the global silos and the huge divide between the Western world and the Eastern world when it comes to clinical trials. A majority of the clinical trials are conducted in the Western world. That's where the investments are. That's where the biotech sponsors are. That's where the regulators are, FDA and EMA. However, patients are global and diseases know no borders. And so these patients are located all over the world. And the biggest pain point that customers told us is patient recruitment. You know, it takes a long time to recruit the target number of patients. How do we speed this up? And in what I have figured is that there is no way we can achieve the acceleration in clinical development without making global clinical trials easy and cost efficient. So we founded this nonprofit Indo-US organization for rare diseases, which is a membership organization. We work with patient advocacy groups from both US, India, and globally, where we help connect, make connections between the various stakeholders between the two countries. The corporate alliance, which is mainly meant for biotech sponsors, we advocate that they include prevalence and incidence of the rare diseases in their FDA submissions. When they make a investigational new drug application or a BLA, we want them to include the prevalence and incidence in Indian subcontinent as well. That would be a great starting point. So now the market size suddenly can increase for them, as if they are only focused on the US market, which they have to price the product at a much higher price to recover the return on investment. Lastly, education, awareness, and research programs, you know, where possible collaborative projects between US and Indian stakeholders working together. So we disseminate information about our the rare diseases represented by our members via newsletters, quarterly webinars meant for education purposes, and omni-channel, and so on. So we do policy advocacy both here on the Capitol Hill every year. We have February, last week of February is the Rare Disease Week. So we engage with the US-India Congressional Caucus to make rare disease and orphan drug development a priority in their bilateral relationships with India. These are some of our member organizations representing over 70 rare diseases and over 14,000 patients, members in these organizations. So that brings us to the problem that we are trying to solve with technology, which is the travel burden. You know, if we do global clinical trials, great, but how are patients going to travel as when it's needed? You know, we can reduce the amount of travel, but we cannot completely eliminate them in a orphan drug clinical trial, especially if it's a cell therapy or a gene therapy, which are the most advanced forms of treatments. For most of the rare genetic diseases, gene therapy is the ultimate goal, as they tend to be curative in that you fix the underlying cause, the genetic mutation. And what that means is it has to be administered in a in-person setting. And hence, the travel burden can be a problem. If it's a life-threatening disease, rare disease patients are willing to travel the world, go to the other side of the planet and get that treatment, especially in clinical trials where it is sponsored by the biotech company. The patients don't have to pay anything out of their pocket most of the time. And so they are willing to travel. However, that's a huge bottleneck in conducting clinical trials, especially if that travel has to occur after they have received the one-time treatment over a period of 5, 10, or 15 years. Like now it is expected by FDA that for all gene therapies, patients be monitored for 15 years. And that's where we identified that as a key problem. And to address that, what we need is a flexible, customizable platform that can enable management of scheduling these in-person or remote visits, as it may be appropriate for a given clinical trial based on the protocol, and move the needle more towards the patient-centric model, where patients only have to travel when it's really necessary or when the patients choose to, rather than making it a requirement. That can help speed up the global engagement as well as more patient-centric travel burden reduction. So what we developed, there is a software platform, a 4-in-1 platform, which brings the best-in-class remote touchless electronic informed consent, patient-reported outcomes, video conferencing consults like this to replace in-person consultations, especially for follow-up visits and clinical assessments. That helps reduce the software validation and training timelines significantly. Also, bring your own device. You know, some of these products are only developed for Apple products, and that decreases the ability for patients using other devices to participate in clinical trials. So we took a bring your own device approach instead. So we are at release 1.0 right now, and we are launching it with a number of children's hospitals, academic university medical centers, where clinical research is conducted. So we are seeking additional early adopters. If you're interested, we can talk both in US, but also open to other English speaking countries to begin with. In the next 6 months, we plan to make it more global with multiple language support and ability to address global clinical studies as well. That's our remote touchless electronic informed consent platform that's just about to be launched next month. So contact us if you have any of these use cases in terms of investigator-initiated studies at a medical center or a gene therapy or organ transplant study where the organ has been transplanted like a bone marrow transplant but needs to be monitored over a long period of time. We don't want to burden the patients from having to come into the clinic each time. They can do it from their home using our platform, a single platform for managing, scheduling, bidirectional communication, and routine follow-ups. So in summary, key takeaways for my talk is that rare disease research and orphan drug development have come as far as possible in the Western world, and any future progress and significant acceleration can only be achieved by bridging these silos and the global silo between the East and the West. As well as data and technology can and should play a key enabling role. As Dr. Shafi Ahmed's talk also alluded to, decentralization is key in clinical research in particular, as well as cross-border collaborations are critical. So to drive home the point, while there is a booming innovation industry, particularly in healthcare, a new startup created every day, a new app being launched every minute, the actual experience of delivering or receiving care is changing scarcely. And that to me is a very striking observation and something to note. So where we are, I as a social entrepreneur, my goal is to have an impact and drive that change in behavior and adoption of these technologies rather than just putting an app out there, which may not really drive the adoption. So if you like to contact either the Indo-US organization from a patient or a corporate alliance standpoint, you can reach me at indousrare.org. Or if you like to discuss collaborations on the remote touchless electronic informed consent or remote clinical trials, you can reach me on jeevatrials.com. Thank you so much for listening. Thanks for having me again, and look forward to Q&A session later.
Thanks, Harsha. That was good. I'm gonna hold on to the Q&A until we actually finish Todd's talk. Todd, over to you.
How's everyone doing? Thank you very much for your time today. Thank you very much for joining and caring about this topic. I can assure you that from the front lines, quote unquote, it is critical that we find better ways to innovate and to drive innovation with what we are trying to do in the industry of healthcare. So a quick slide about me just to put in here. I think Sweta had announced earlier that I've been doing this for 3 decades and not continually, but I started out writing my first lines of commercial code that was included in a commercially licensed product in the 1980s. I was in junior high school and I had a neighbor who had worked for a large corporation. That corporation decided to end of life the product line that he and a few of his peers worked on. And in a inspirational moment of desperation, he turned around on them and said, "Hey, you have a lot of customers who pay maintenance and it may not be a good business for you, but those customers still need help. So how about you give me the equipment and I'll pay you a licensing fee and I'll continue to run the business." So in the very early 1980s, at the dawn of the PC era, I witnessed my neighbor have a large delivery truck unloading what appeared to be computers into his basement. And I just, my jaw dropped wide open, because in the early 1980s, you didn't see a lot of computing going into a residential sector. The IBM PC had just really been launched and there were some executives that had them around, but not many other people. And one night at a dinner party in the neighborhood, I just sat there waiting my turn as a young child to speak with Mr. Marshall. And I just blurted out, "Do you have computers in your basement?" And he said, why, yes, I do. And that started a relationship where he took me under his wing, taught me how to do some coding, and allowed me to contribute to what was then an agricultural management software. So that was my first lines of commercial code. I went on to work with many different organizations over the years. I've been a serial entrepreneur. I currently teach big data and analytics at Emory University. And I work as a CIO, CISO in healthcare. So I've had multiple years with the Pediatric Research Alliance, which includes Children's Healthcare of Atlanta, Georgia Tech. And now I'm serving as Dr. Sneha had said earlier, on the Pacific Northwestern coast. I'm currently in Alaska, working with rural healthcare environments. And I'm going to talk a little bit today about what it's like on the pandemic from maybe an area that sees much less innovation than some of the urban centers that I've come from and that some of our other speakers work in on a daily basis. And it's been eye-opening and it's been enlightening. So the three basic tenets that I have today are one of them is that healthcare is really complex. And I think you've gotten that indication from the first two speakers. There is a ton of data that's coming in, and it's any clinical workflow, any patient story, it's anything that comes in from devices now. Sometimes those are like BARDX monitors that go onto a patient and stay with them that are provided by the healthcare provider. Other times it can be things that were alluded to earlier, Apple devices, Samsung, Android devices, different types of health monitors, Fitbits. It creates a lot of data, but in the traditional sense, even before we were electronic, before we were using EMRs and EHRs, the data would sometimes be structured where somebody would check off a box or write in a discrete prescription of some kind, but more often than not, it's natural language. And it's very difficult for computers to process human language. When you look at each human saying something in a slightly different way, or each human writing something in a slightly different way, for a computer to help us to grab that information together. And only recently have we gotten very good and highly accurate at doing that. So a human being creates a lot of data. You multiply that by all the human beings a doctor has to see and all the human beings that all the doctors in the healthcare system have to see. And you can quickly see, you know, our responsibility is to grab that data. 80% of it is seen as unstructured data. So you're not putting it in a category or having a dropdown or a checkbox in an electronic form. It's unstructured notes, it's provider input, it's patient stories that they've related. You have to understand the context and the meaning and the indicators. You have to be able to tease out the signal and the noise. And sometimes the noise, what seems to be the noise, is really the important stuff in treating human beings. We have complex systems that are individualized based upon not only our genetics, but also our toxins. What have we been exposed to throughout the course of life that may have influenced our body's operations and potentially altered our genetics? So if you look at all this, it's highly complex. And then ultimately we have this mission, which is to use that data, use that understanding for good. One of the prior speakers talked about precision medicine, and it's one of the most exciting fields that I look at all the time, whether it's, you know, looking at genetics or looking at the evolution of the disease and the pathways, or looking at how clinical research can apply to bringing new cures or treatments or therapies. But at the same time, it's kind of one side of the coin. And so using data for good, using our information and skills for good is really important. It's a fundamental thing, because if you take those same skills, you take that same information, you take that same treatment approach, look at several years ago, President Jimmy Carter in Atlanta, for example, he had a brain cancer that is thought to be terminal in most cases. He went to Emory University, he had some doctors, they did some genetics, and they used precision medicine. So instead of just treating him with a bath of chemicals through chemotherapy, they were able to treat that specific type of tumor based on its genetics, that specific person based upon his genetics, and they were able to find a match. And he's lived a high quality life for many, many more years than what that initial prognosis had been. If you take that same approach and you turn it to the other side of the coin, however, it could be a precision weapon. And we've seen these things play out time and time again in the national stage and the international stage. If you look at Novichok toxic poisonings that have occurred in Europe based upon national and state actors, if you think about someone taking the skills of precision medicine and applying it to where you can actually have a genetic read for something that, that could be used for a nefarious purpose, this is a fundamental difference. We need to use our data for good. We need to do things that advance the human condition and the human cause, and we need to be in on the lookout for bad actors that might want to use the same technology in different ways and try to identify and eliminate that opportunity. So data can tell us about that too. If you look at healthcare, there's a huge problem, and it was also alluded to prior speakers, that, that we are not a very innovative industry. I mean, I say that tongue in cheek because reality is we innovate a lot. It's just, it's a lot of mass and inertia moving at its own speed. So a huge amount of innovation in one small area takes a long time to have much of an impact across the entire industry. We are based on tradition. We're based on doctors who are specialists who have extraordinarily high levels of information and sometimes intuition and knowledge about one area of medicine. And it may not translate well into another area of medicine. So you could have, you know, an environmental issue that could be misdiagnosed as an allergy. You can have all sorts of things now that you have to determine what the root cause is to see what the actual condition may be and how to treat it. And this is highly complex. Doctors have been charged with this for millennia, and as the profession has evolved and healthcare providers in general. And data can be an important part of teasing out that signal to noise to help the doctors with assistive technologies, decision support systems, and looking at other conditions around the world through registries and data intervention. You know, that if you look at a lot of the results, you know, from these, that three doctors can diagnose a problem in three different ways. And if you think about that, that translates in the US at least to about 40,000 ICU patients that die each year due to a misdiagnosis. So if we can capture just a percentage of that, we can really improve upon misdiagnosis by looking at the facts, looking at the data, and in some cases, you know, providing potential solutions that a provider may not look at in the narrow amount of time that they have. You know, EHRs and EMRs, the electronic medical systems, are often based by providers, are judged and evaluated by providers based upon the number of patients per hour that a provider can see. And so there are rankings out there that, that say, you know, with EMR type one, maybe you can see three patients an hour. With EMR type two, you can only see 1.8. When you think about this, if we're looking at moving towards socialized medicine and we're looking at scarcity and we look at the reality of labor in even good metropolitan markets where you have access to a lot of solid healthcare providers that, that don't have to travel and don't have even more limited time and resources, we often find that they're spending less than 15 or 20 minutes with a patient on a serious condition. And that's a challenge. So we in the world of innovation and technology have a mandate to try to make those amounts of time, as precious as they are, more valuable. So where does all the data come from today? Well, you know, not only does it come from the hospital or from clinics or nursing homes, it comes from pharmacies, it goes between public health resources, it comes from the population itself through their own devices, inputs. If you have a login or a terminal that allows you to access via the web your patient record with your provider, you may be asked to look at your lab results or to put certain information in from time to time. And then also rehab clinics and then ambulatory and specialty clinics. It's a complex mishmash where not everyone follows one standard. And although we do have emerging capabilities for electronic medical records to be shared, that is still not necessarily universal. And if you're not in the same environment or the same healthcare system, often you're going to be looking at data from different systems that could be interpreted or indeed translated or indeed by the way providers have written it in natural language, documented differently. So where does this data come? Well, currently we're kind of looking at Fitbits and we're looking at Holter monitors and we're looking at things that come from clinical backgrounds as well. You get about 10% of a person's data comes from clinical data itself. So that's about 0.4 of a terabyte per lifetime. if you were to incorporate genomics data, that will be about another 30% by volume of an overall patient's data. And that leaves that you have 60% that's, you know, exogenous. So you've got 1,100 terabytes generated per lifetime that has volume, variety, velocity, veracity, you know, the four Vs that are typically discussed in big data. Now there's a debate whether it's four Vs or six Vs, you can add different things to it, but that's the environmental data that kind of comes and allows us to see on a whole what might be happening to that patient when they're not in front of a provider, when they're not being tracked, when they're not being looked at through the lens of their genetics. And one of the problems that we're having is being able to take all of this data and then process it effectively. So something that I worked on previously was transitive architectural approaches. And that's the idea that certain workloads are best put in certain environments, whether you have a private infrastructure in a server sitting in a doctor's office or a data center that's supporting a hospital. And in some cases, you want to be able to move that data in a secure and flexible manner into an Amazon, Azure, or Google Cloud, for example, where you don't have to build big data and analytics tools necessarily on-premise, which can be highly expensive and prone to maintenance failure and budgetary cuts. You can instead move non-operational data for analysis into the cloud. And it's interesting that the prior speaker was talking about doing this with clinical trials too, because I was involved as the head of research in academic technology at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta for a number of years. And having cloud-based systems were often seen as a barrier because hospitals don't want to give up the data. And they see it as something that, you know, they have a mandate. There's a regulatory mandate to make sure you're protecting that data. So anytime you put any bit of data, whether it's de-identified or not, up into a cloud, there could be security considerations. Now, the great thing is over the last 5 years, those barriers have started to normalize because there have been normal cybersecurity frameworks that have been applied to these applications and environments where providers and healthcare systems are starting to get over it. They're starting to realize that we can secure things in some cases even better in a cloud environment than we can in our own because there are pooled concerns and there's much more maintenance that is done on a regular basis than what any single healthcare system could support. But the need to be able to shift workloads between what is in my private infrastructure and what makes sense to have additional processing or additional transactional operations somewhere else is something that's relatively new to healthcare. It's been happening for 20 years in industry across businesses and commerce, but it's only really only been happening in the last 5 to 10 years at most in healthcare. And for commercial healthcare, nonprofits, hospitals and such, really that's been focused in the last 5 years. So that kind of innovation needs to continue because it saves cost, allows resources to be deployed elsewhere, and really improves patient care, whether it's in clinical research, whether it's in analytics, or whether it's in day-to-day ambulatory operations. Another area where these technologies can be very effective is in processes for Medicaid and Medicare processing. So you have situations where, like for example, in the state of Georgia, recent year was about 25% of the state's budget, overall budget, was really taken up by Medicare and Medicaid. It was about $5.5 billion that was coming into the state in the form of reimbursements. And if you look at the legacy system, there are 49 plus subsystems, you have 17 different working groups, you have 30-year-old technology, you have things that are working in a way that, you know, quite frankly, are dissatisfiers. They don't give any observability, and that can lend easily to fraud. And so we've seen this in the newspapers across the nation many times and across the globe in different types of reimbursement schemes, where fraud can easily work its way into a system. And due to a lack of observability on those transactions, it takes auditing after the fact to discover that fraud. And that creates a lot of inefficiency. So the nice thing is about modern architectures, if you're looking at using things like containerization and serverless computing, and you have data and analytics processing at every step of the way, you can do audit checks and you can catch that fraud much more easily. What that does is that returns efficiencies and capital back into the system so that that healthcare system can operate more efficiently and deliver more on patient care. Something for the future. You know, a typical model that we see today is that on the left-hand side, you might have some kind of operational database. This is taken from an Epic model where Epic is the EMR and you have a Chronicles database, you have a Clarity data warehouse, and you have a Caboodle self-service data capability. And you have other systems that might be out there. They might be running Lawson or Workday as an ERP system. They could have some Cisco data, some service and networking data. And the organizations now are starting to look at bringing all of this together inside of data warehouses and data lakes and looking at where they can squeeze some operational efficiencies out. And one way they can do that is by integrating their data up into an Azure data factory or another fabric from one of the other cloud providers. And what that does is it gives them for the first time the ability to look at what's happening in the hospital and what's happening with their patients at any moment throughout a day or through an event. It can yield great insights into things like staffing, making sure you have appropriate staffing that's already scheduled and that those staff shifts are filled. It can yield a lot of data in terms of where my costs are. Do I really need to have an RN or an LPN when maybe a CNA on the floor would suffice for the main duties that are going on in volume at that day? You know, is there a way that I can improve patient care by maybe looking at seasonality around certain types of medications or certain types of materials so I can order them in bulk and get them in sooner? Particularly those hospitals and healthcares that are looking at those items over the last, you know, year or more have benefited because we had a lot of supply chain failures in the last year. Supply chain failures that we've not really seen in the industry before. So with the pandemic, with the slowdown in production and manufacturing, the slowdown in distribution, we were thankfully able to overcome some of those, but we still see them. And now that spikes are occurring around the globe again with the advent of winter, driving people indoors, increasing population densities, we're seeing spikes of COVID again. And so we're already starting to see some supply chain shortages, particularly in chemicals and reactants to actually run the tests. So while you may have a lot of COVID test kits, there are a lot of areas around the nation that still can't get the reactants necessary to deliver those test results. So what are we doing in healthcare to try to address these things? Well, to the innovative approaches that were presented by the first two speakers, we are also attempting across the board and digital transformation. So some of that is putting things up into the cloud. Some of that is migrating from legacy architectures. Some of it is just as simple as taking what have been paper-based processes for things like contract processing or payment requests and moving them into online forms where you can scan PDFs or you can attach things and run it through e-signatures for authorizations. These are huge problems that you know, chew up hours and days per week of time just to process something. So getting those inefficiencies out at the most basic level is really important. I've been working, as Dr. Sneha had said earlier, in rural healthcare for this year through the pandemic. And so it's become something that, you know, I've looked at over the last several years as I've gone through being a serial entrepreneur, and I've worked as a manager and a head of a department or a team inside of pediatrics, and then worked in the research side of healthcare technology. My career has come now during the pandemic, sitting on the sidelines, kind of doing just regular technology work in healthcare. I wanted to get directly involved. I do have a background of training as an EMT. I did that as a technologist because I wanted to be able to walk a mile in a provider's shoes. I think it's important that in a career that I am able to have one foot in the provider world and one foot firmly in the technology world and be able to translate back and forth between those two to provide maximum service to the people that I'm trying to work with in the organizations I'm trying to benefit. And in rural healthcare, that message rings more soundly than it does perhaps in other environments, because in rural healthcare, there are unique challenges. And I'm not going to go through all of these bullet points. I realize that slide fatigue can set in, but I do want to point out that in the United States, we have a lot of data and statistics that drives this, but I want to also point out that around the world, globally, rural healthcare is a challenge. Telemedicine is a huge benefit. In the state of Georgia, for example, in 1996, prior to the Olympics, we had in the metropolitan Atlanta area and other metropolitan areas, very good rates of healthcare. But if you were to go to South Georgia, you were to go to rural Georgia, we had infant mortality rates that would rival third world countries. And in some cases, we had absolutely no ability to support things like specialties like pediatric cardiology. And so we worked very hard as a state to gain support for telemedicine, to put technologists, med techs out into rural areas that could, through telemedicine, consult with pediatric cardiology specialists that were in metropolitan areas. And that model has grown and gained over the last 25 years to where it makes revolutionary benefits available to villages through satellite technology. If we get lower Earth orbit satellites like the Starlink system that SpaceX is starting to deploy now, down to cost-effective areas, they're saying they're going to do $99 per month for bandwidth. If that actually occurs, then I think the telemedicine is at a point now where it will be able to be a game changer. And similar levels of healthcare improvement will be had in rural areas around the globe, as we can see in urban areas. And the things that you're seeing that the prior speakers were talking about, you know, the ability to work remotely, the ability to virtually be there with your patient, to not put yourself at risk and to increase the number of patients you can see in a day. I think that through that type of last mile stretch through low Earth orbit satellites, we're going to finally see those benefits be delivered more uniformly throughout the globe. But in the US, if you take that as a model, you know, we've had, before the pandemic, for the last 10 years, we've had 95 rural hospitals close since January of 2010. 32 of those were called critical access hospitals. So, you know, critical access hospitals serve not only a foundational need from healthcare, but they also serve in many of these communities a foundational need from economic development. You know, a hospital is seen as a stable area for people to get jobs. It is a stable area for economics to work in the local area's favor, because vendors that are locally based can be used as resources and sources to feed and provide for that hospital. Reimbursements that come for insurance for retiring people or people who have moved into and out of the area, et cetera, can drive that economic engine, therefore helping close gaps around disparities. So when a rural healthcare facility closes, particularly one that's a critical access hospital, it makes a huge impact on the area. And it's not just in the level of care, it's in the level of economic benefit and development. Very often it's in education opportunities. Very often it can really drag the entire area down. Much like education is a game changer around the world, healthcare having a presence is also a game changer around the world for these communities. So, three separate things that we've looked at and problems: emergent ones, opioid epidemic is a good one, cyber threats is a good one, recent ones that have come up in the last 5 to 10 years, and then persistent ones. And then we had the pandemic hit. The pandemic changed everything. It greatly accelerated the need for digital transformation. It greatly accelerated the need to adapt new technologies. CMS and Health and Human Services in the United States actually allowing telemedicine to be reimbursable across state lines has been a game changer, because as you can see that there are health professional shortage areas in the United States, both for primary care and for mental health. As you will see, even in urban areas, there are some urban areas that perhaps may not be in the top 10 cities where there are shortages occurring as well. So telemedicine is a game changer, and I'm hoping that this pandemic has forced long and lasting change upon the industry, that we can rise to the occasion and therefore make healthcare delivery a little more uniform with the assistance of technology. You know, steps forward that we're taking directly in the hospitals that I'm working with today is we're looking at, you know, ways to affect culture. So things that have always been done that way and are not necessarily the way to do it today. We're trying to enforce and increase and improve transparency, collaboration, mutual respect. We're doing that through innovation. We're introducing new cybersecurity frameworks that maybe rural healthcare hasn't seen in the past. We're also doing data-driven decision-making. And in a way, we're doing that by allowing residencies and fellowships for data scientists who may not be local to the area, but who now through remote working and telework can work with one another to drive solutions for rural healthcare providers by getting access to technology and skill sets that they've not seen before. So by doing remote data science residency and fellowship progression, we are seeding reporting and data science within rural healthcare providers, allowing them to change the fabric of their delivery, their options, and for providers to see information that they've not seen before. The tenets of the program, and I'm advocating that we take this nationwide and more areas adopt it, you know, you have a 3-month minimum commitment. It's a virtual commitment. It can be part-time, some offer small stipends, some don't, and it allows them to gain work experience, get resume feedback, job referral, and potential for additional certifications. It's a game changer that allows technical skills to be delivered to remote areas that can actually be transformative in the way that we support those rural areas. And finally, if there's any interest by anyone in the audience engaging around rural healthcare, there are some data sets that I just wanted to make available. And those data sets allow people to grab things that can, you know, emerging data science, if you're interested in getting engaged in rural healthcare and digital transformation, you can contact me and you can grab these data sets.
Oh, of course. Thank you, Todd. That was fascinating. And your journey is, like I said, is you've been through all the places and you've seen the whole thing explode and converge. But we are all in the middle of the pandemic, and the one thing that's been across on all our minds is how is it going to impact the workforce of the future, because education has been impacted and disrupted in more ways than one. I love the idea of having remote residencies, Todd, and I'm really glad that you're developing those. Can you speak a little bit about, you know, how anybody who wants to be part of that residency can be engaged with you? And Harsha, I know you work a bunch with future residents and future aspirants of people who are trying to get into clinical trials and in technology. So, you know, both of you and your perspective on how remote experiences can shape future workforce.
And I'd like Harsha to go first, actually. His area of clinical trials is a passion of mine. Research technology is a huge enabler. And I saw it work at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta to improve and pulling them up to a fifth ranking in the NIH pediatric rankings. And I would love to hear his take on it today.
Certainly. Thank you for that question, Svetan. And thank you for that comment, Todd. As much as I like to give a sexy answer of all the wearable and, you know, all the cool stuff, AR, VR, and it's all nice to see, but I think where the real need is in still very basic stuff, like, you know, getting a remote electronic informed consent to pediatric children's research studies is such a huge unmet need. You know, right, most of the tools work for adults, and in fact, 97% of all clinical trials and research happen on adults first. And so there is a severe lack of treatments for pediatric and children affected by any disease for that matter. You know, some of it is for good reason, because it's always safer to test on adults before we, touch the pediatric, but it's also a lot of the gaps in technology and the focus to support these workflows. You know, an assent is different from a consent. And so that's where I think there is still enormous opportunity to innovate and adopt and drive the adoption. In addition to, you know, all these other cooler technologies are important and can be integrated. The technology is not as much of a limiting factor here as it is the culture and the adoption and driving the change. A behavioral change on a grander scale needs to occur. I think I love the rural health focus that Todd described. In some sense, the mobility issue is what we both are trying to solve. From just slightly from a different perspective, you know, it's both rural but also geographic sparsity of the patients locations. You know, instead of having to limit ourselves to 50-mile radius of Atlanta, we can now go global for the same 50 patients who are now located in 50 different places rather than all located within 50 miles of Atlanta. That's a huge change that can be driven by technology.
Thank you so much, both of you, for joining us today. And everyone should have your contact information in case they want to reach out for you for any further discussion. Thanks again, guys. James?
So thank you very much for joining. Thank you to all of the panelists for doing such a great presentation. And thank you to our attendees as well.